So this is the Easter season, and this is your geek out nerd fact, in that Easter is not just one Sunday, it is 50 days. How many days was Lent? 40. How many days is Easter? Oh yeah, okay, all right. So we have a whole season of new life. We have a whole season of more. This is the time where we begin to understand the new truth that Jesus was trying to show us, because we knew Jesus to be fully human. Now we know Jesus as fully divine. And that begins to unfold. As the Gospel according to John says, we don't know who God is, but Jesus makes God known to us. Jesus is the window, the door, the pathway into that new truth, into that more. And Easter is the season of more. And so we find God's divinity and Christ. We find God's new life in Christ. We find that Jesus isn't just a ghost, that there's more than that. And this is the time where we begin to open ourselves up to what that more can be and what that more means for us. Now, 2,000 years after this, we've had a lot of practice of a lot of 50-day seasons of Easter, right, to get excited about this more and this new life. But it was pretty complicated at the first season. Do you all remember the Easter egg children's sermon, right, where we take the eggs, we know what life looks like, we know there's a beginning, Diana's working on that beginning right now, and there's going to be a middle, and there's going to be an end, and the egg yolk breaks out, and we know what death looks like, we know what the end looks like, until Jesus comes, and instead of a yolk, there's glitter. And all of a sudden, death doesn't look quite what we thought it looked. Well, thank goodness, there's more. And so this is the season of more, where we try to figure out what it means for the natural order that we thought to be and we knew to be. All of a sudden, there's more. So, for a comparison, who here misses Pluto? Right? I miss Pluto. This is the chart I had. This is what I knew to be true. Pluto was a planet. There's also some awesome cartoons of all the other planets circling up and kicking Pluto out and Pluto being like, whatever, guys. Yeah, right? I mean, that's the sympathy. We miss Pluto. And so you have Thomas who's like, I've got my mobile made. And until I see Pluto face to face, I am believing that Pluto is a planet. This is the truth. And then you have Peter, who just feels really, really guilty. Like, well, I denied Jesus. And if Jesus comes back, I don't think I want to face Jesus again. I'm not going to know what to do with that new truth. It's going to break me. It has already broken me, but to have to look him in the face and acknowledge what I did, I can't do that. And then you have all of the scientists, right, who knew that Pluto wasn't a planet for a while but didn't know how to break the news to anybody else. Do you remember the Gospel according to Mark and how the women went and told no one because they were so terrified when they met the angel and found out that Jesus wasn't there? So how do we do new truth? How does Jesus, in eating fish with us and coming and showing us his wounds and walking with us that whole road to Emmaus to teach us the scriptures, to help us in our confusion, to help us see and understand? This is a season of new truth. And so we don't have Jesus with us to walk along with us in that Emmaus road anymore, so we turn to scripture. But who's ever done the moment where they break scripture, the Bible open to whatever passage, and it's a really terrifying passage, and it's just, and we won't even talk about what passages that could have been, but it's less than helpful. Scriptures are really beautiful, but a really complicated thing. And that's what we're here to talk about in this season. Because if this is the place that we're going to go to understand who we are and what our purpose is as followers of Christ and how we live infinite truth as finite beings, then we've also got to figure out what our understanding of Scripture is and how we use it. And this is the season of there's more, right? So we're really good as people of just choosing one way. And so we can approach Scripture from a purely faith standpoint and not use reason at all and just trust and believe that this is the divine word of God and that everything that is contained in it is the literal word of God coming from God that God wants us to hear, and that is that. And we're really good at that, or we're really good at the opposite extreme of using our reason only and picking apart scientifically and historically what happened, trying to find who that historical Jesus really was, but then we lose all the more, right? We lose the mystery, and all of a sudden we try to say that the resurrection didn't really happen, the virgin birth didn't really happen, and we limit God to what we can handle and understand in our finitude. And come on this month, on the 29th, we're going to have another meeting after church on Scripture and walk through the historical timeline. For those of you at the next one, you know how we go through movements, right? That we're like, whoop, no, whoop, no, whoop, and trying to do both approaches to Scripture and how we live from a tradition that calls us to find both in balance. For those of you who haven't been to Wesley Seminary, where Bill and I went to study, the sanctuary is right across from the library. You can look into both at the same time. And on the cornerstone of the library is the quote from John Wesley, "Unite the two so long disjoined, knowledge and vital piety." It's really hard to keep them together. But that is our call as United Methodists, to understand that Scripture was written by human beings and so brings a finitude and a limit to it, but was also divinely inspired and so goes way beyond that limitation, and to be able to hold both together in understanding and approach and how it leads and guides our faith. And because we're United Methodists, we wrote a song about it. And that song is number 2004 in The Faith We Sing, and Barry's going to bring that up for us. It's "Praise the Source of Faith and of Learning, of Both and." And this is the prayer that's in verse 2. "God of wisdom, we acknowledge that our science and our art and the breath of human knowledge only partial truth impart." This is from Paul in his letter to the Corinthians. "We see now dimly as in a mirror, but then we shall see face to face. Far beyond our calculation lies a depth we cannot sound, where your purpose for creation and the pulse of life are found." Remember that God is the creator, and there is a life pulse there. And so the prayer continues, "May our faith redeem the blunder of believing that our thought has displaced the grounds for wonder which the ancient prophets taught." We need to understand, we need to seek that, but it can't be the end. There has to be more. There has to be curiosity and wonder for what is beyond us, and a celebration that, thank goodness, the world isn't that small, because that would be pretty boring and pretty awful. But then on the flip side of that, may our learning curb the error that unthinking faith can bring, lest we justify some terror with an antiquated creed. And that was our Good Friday service. We remember how the Dutch Reformed Church supported apartheid with Scripture through faith. We remember how we did that ourselves in America in slavery. And so we bring thinking to this as well. And it's not an easy balance to find, but we pray that as two currents in a river fight each other's undertone, till converging they deliver one coherent, steady flow. Blend, O God, our faith and our learning, till they carve a single course, till they join as one, returning praise and thanks to you, their source. Because we are made in the image of God. And so if we are made by a creator who gives us reason, what God gives us a gift and then asks us not to use it and to leave it by the wayside. But then also we are made in the image of God. We are created. We are not creator. And what being would want us as parents, right? We lead our children and we teach them about not overreaching and not becoming so arrogant in our limitation that we think that we are the creator and that we've got all the answers and that it's all set all in front of us and we can take care of everything alone. And so it's both and. There's more. And so we come to this season, we come to this Easter season being people of more. Being people who see the need for both and, being people who recognize that Jesus is the definitive, unmitigated word of God. Because when we take scripture, when we take our Bibles and profess them to be the word of God, we are saying that there is truth in them for them to transform our lives and our world. And that is an incredible power to be stewards of. And so we come in joy with the gift that they are, whether we are the woman of the parable who has swept her house clean to find that one lost coin, and we have searched and we have tried and we have given all of who we are and going through the word of God to find its truth and to claim it for ourselves. Or we can be the one who stumbled along a field and found a treasure there, wasn't looking for anything, but found it and knew what he had found to the point where he put it back down, went and got all of his things in order and bought that field, gave everything that he had to buy that field because he knew what he had found. May we pursue truth, God's more, in such a way. May we pursue it with all we have, or may, as it comes up in our life, may we claim it with all that we have. But we have to give room for there to be more. And we have to give room for it to be complicated. We don't know the story of what the wife said when the husband went back and was like, I'm selling everything we have for this one field. We don't know how hard it was. We don't know how risky it was. We don't know what happened after he got that field and what obstacles he still had to work through. So when we make the claim that this is the word of God and to the truth of God, it gets a little complicated because scripture's complicated. Because if we believe it to be the literal word of God, where every word of that scripture comes from God, then we're going to have trouble. Because when we say it's the word of God, there are whole chapters that don't have any word from God in them. Like the Psalms, for instance, are our words to God, our prayers to God, not God's word to us. And in the book of Job, the devil has some words in there. And what happens then when we come to Psalm 137? When the Jews have been exiled to Babylon and they're crying by the rivers in a foreign land, when their captors ask us for songs and our tormentors ask us for mirth, saying, sing us one of the songs of Zion. And they respond, how can we sing the Lord's song in a foreign land? If I forget you, O Jerusalem, let my right hand wither. Let my tongue cling to the roof of my mouth. If I do not remember you, if I do not set Jerusalem above my highest joy. Remember, O Lord, against the Edomites, the day of Jerusalem's fall, how they said, tear it down, down to its foundation. O daughter Babylon, you devastator. Happy shall they be who pay you back for what you have done to us. Happy shall they be who take your little ones and dash them against the rock. If we claim that this is the word of God, that God says, happy are those who take babies and dash them against the rocks, we've got trouble. Because that's real harm. And so we turn to Jesus, because Jesus is the word of God that we have in Scripture that doesn't come through human limitation. Jesus is the more for us. Besides the Ten Commandments written with the finger of God, Jesus is the word that we have in Scripture that human authorship has nothing to do with. And as we read from John, Jesus was in the beginning. Jesus is the living word. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. It is through this word, it is through Jesus that we know God. And so when we come up against passages like that psalm, we go to Jesus. And this is what Jesus has to teach us. From the Sermon on the Mount, the very first lesson, Barry, that Jesus ever taught or gave. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I feel like dashing the enemy's babies against the rock is a fair way of assuming that that was hate. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you so that you may be children of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good and sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Did not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. In loving the Babylonians, those who caused the exile, and the Israelites, those who were exiled. And so this is the example of how we approach Scripture, of how we wrestle with understanding its complications, and how we bring that to Jesus, because Scripture is our guide, but Jesus is our ultimate authority as Christians, because Jesus is the definitive, unmitigated word of God. And so when a question or a conflict arises, we turn to Christ for how to find our way forward. But I want to circle back to Psalm 137, because a lot of folks and Christians upon reaching this point say, okay, well then we don't need the Hebrew Bible at all because Jesus is our truth and that is what we need. And so we can just skip that step completely and just follow Christ. That was actually the very first heresy the early church refuted in Marcion, who wanted to cut out the Hebrew scriptures and that the early church claimed as needed. Because even though this isn't a word of God, it still contains truth for our salvation. Truth for what we do when our lives are so obliterated and devastated, we don't know how to step forward. So I'm not going to talk about Pluto, but I am going to read a passage from Adam Hamilton's book that helps us understand how the truth of Psalm 137 is needed. So go back with me to the summer of 587 BC. After a long siege of Jerusalem, the Babylonian army finally breached its walls. They burned the homes in the city. They captured the Jewish king and his sons. The Babylonian leaders made the king watch as they killed his sons. Then they gouged out his eyes so that the last thing he would see was the death of his sons and the heirs to his throne. The Babylonians then plundered the temple of its wealth, the holy things before, then setting the temple on fire. The people stood and wept as they watched it burn. The temple had stood for nearly 400 years as a sign of God's presence in their midst. So now remember 9/11, and the entire city this time, imagine not just the Pentagon, but an entire city of Washington, D.C. destroyed. Not just the Pentagon, but the White House, Congress, and all the homes inside the Beltway. Imagine seeing the president's children killed and then the president blinded and led away in chains. Then imagine many of the leading citizens of America forcibly relocated to a far-off country while America is overrun with foreign troops with no hope of ever regaining freedom. This is the experience of the Jewish people in exile. And And this is the truth that this word has to teach us of how to deal with such moments in a way that God can lead us through. Barry, I have one more scripture, right? This is the pain and the grief that the prophet Isaiah spoke to when he said, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me and he has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." That has new meaning, having just read what happened in the exile, right? We can feel the relief flood through our bodies and our souls. There's hope in the midst of the hopeless. This is the very passage that Jesus used in the Gospel according to Luke to announce his ministry. And so we as Christians know the depth of this truth then for the Babylonian exile and the Israelites trapped. And now, that was long before Jesus ever arrived on the scene. This is the power of the Word of God. This is the ancient present truth. The truth that brings our salvation then for the Israelites, again for those under Roman occupation, and again for those of us who have experienced the terror of 9/11. This is the living word of God. This is the new truth. This is the more that we have. And so saying that there is human authorship and partnership does not demean the fullness of Scripture any way. It is what gives us hope and life that God would choose to partner with us in every age and in every time to bring truth and to bring hope and to bring salvation. And so, friends, in this Easter season, we celebrate the definitive, unmitigated Word of God who brings a truth to us that will transform us and transform the world we live in.